On one side, pounding surf. On the other, looming mountains and rugged gorges. Building it pushed road and bridge engineers to new heights. Now, buckle up and enjoy the ride on the most spectacular roadway in America, the Pacific Coast Highway. It took decades for construction crews to carve out, build up, bridge over, tunnel through, and blast their way up all of America's West Coast. The Pacific Coast Highway has become the generally accepted name of the nearly 1,700-mile long highway system that runs from Mexico to Canada. The overall route is made up of three designated roads. The southernmost 79 miles is now the 5 Freeway, a multi-lane thoroughfare to accommodate all types of traffic, including commerce, military, and commuters. Just below California's San Juan Capistrano, Highway 1 begins its 639 miles scenic route. It moves through exclusive beachfront communities, including the movie star colony of Malibu. Built to celebrate some of the most beautiful coastline in the world, the Pacific Coast Highway is an integral part of the Southern California lifestyle. In Central California, Route 1 takes on a whole new personality as it clings to the very edge of the coastal mountain range and passes over some uniquely devised bridges.
The bridges were all designed by engineers from the Division of Highways, and they constitute some of the most spectacular bridges that we have in the state today.
Halfway up California, the road crosses over one of the greatest engineering feats of all time, San Francisco's Golden Gate Bridge. In the northern half of the state, Route 1 hugs the thinly populated shoreline. It's in this area that California Route 1 gives up and lets Highway 101 take over. The 101 serves nearly all of Oregon's coastline and features an impressive set of brilliantly engineered bridges. Then it continues on through the wilds of Washington to the very northwest corner of the continental United States. While the spectacular vistas and unique wildlife attract many tourists all along the Pacific Coast Highway, it is one of those rare cases where a road has become a destination in itself.
It's beautiful, but it's also a wonderful road as roads go. It twirls, it climbs, it drops. And if you have a responsive sports car or a motorcycle, Pacific Coast Highway is the way you want to go because it's just great fun. At the same time, it can be a little bit challenging, a little intimidating because it is risky. It's not a terribly safe road as highways go.
It was over 100 years ago when surveyors first started planning California's highway system. But their initial goal was simply to link county seats to inland highways.
It didn't make sense to put a road along the coast. Except for San Francisco and San Diego, nobody lived along the coast. It means, by definition, you're going to be going by cliffs. You're going to be in areas that are subjected to storms, where there's going to be flooding, where there's going to be a very corrosive environment of the salt water. From a practical standpoint, it's very difficult to justify something like this.
It wasn't until a 1909 highway bond issue that a coast route first appeared on the list of roads to be funded. With Southern California's quickly growing population, developers saw the potential in its shoreline. Construction proceeded slowly at first because it had to rely mostly on muscles, not machines.
The time that construction began on Highway 1, it was really a transition period between human power and horsepower, literally horsepower, and the more modern mechanized age. So initially, a lot of this was done by handwork. It was pick and shovel work. By about the mid-1920s then, we begin to see the transition to more mechanized equipment. Steam shovels were very popular to carve and cut a roadway through this land.
During this early work on the coast route, highway building was still a new and untested science of trial and error. Down near San Diego, A 4-inch thick layer of concrete was poured as a road surface. But it began to break up under the weight of the traffic. It had to be rebuilt, only this time, a grid of steel rebar was laid down first to reinforce the concrete. After a decade, Southern California's highway builders had acquired the experience and the technology needed to tackle a major impasse. Northwest of Los Angeles, a passage needed to be built between the mountains and the pounding surf from above Malibu to a steadfast promontory of solid rock called Point Magoo. The 10-mile section where the hard rock cliffs slam right into the sea had to be surveyed from motorboats. It was clearly going to be a big job and demanded the biggest equipment available.
In order to build a highway through that stretch, the contractor had to bring in steam shovels on ocean barges, actually float them in on the ocean up to the coast and employ them in that area.
In that 10 miles, massive amounts of dirt and solid rock were dug out of the sides of the mountains to create a shelf or bench for the road.
Benching is a technique where they'll put in heavy equipment to simply cut a bench into the hillside onto which the road can be placed. Now, from time to time, they may actually have to start even higher up on the hillside to create a bench and then work their way down to the level where the roadway will eventually run. And benching was a construction technique that was developed by mining companies and later adapted by road construction contractors.
When the shovels couldn't cut it, explosive charges of up to 80,000 pounds were used to reshape the mountains.
The way that they did it was, first, surveyors would rappel down the cliffs and figure out the depth that they needed to go. And then the crews would drill holes in the rock of the cliffs, and then they would fill them up with dynamite. They'd blow up the cliff. And for much of the stretch, they actually built a temporary railroad to haul the debris out.
It took 5 years to get this relatively short section passable. When Route 1 rounds Point Magoo, it soon merges with Highway 101. It was while working on the 101, about 100 miles north of Los Angeles, that California's Department of Highways added bridges to their responsibilities. They had to find a way to get the road across Arroyo Hondo Canyon and decided an arch bridge offered the best solution. In its basic form, an arch bridge is structurally sound because of the way gravity compresses its elements and distributes its weight down to the ground.
Theoretically, you can build an arch and it won't need any reinforcing steel. But the designers of the day knew there was going to be some kind of lateral movement on the structure due to earthquake, due to wind. And as a result of that, they put in reinforcement into the arch. And that reinforcement obviously ties into the columns as well.
The state bridge engineers used the long-established method of erecting a wooden scaffolding, called a falsework, to act as a frame and support during construction. After the concrete is poured and is hardened, the falsework is removed to reveal the finished structure.
It's an open spandrel concrete arch bridge, which is concrete arch with the sides cut out so that just the structure itself is visible. It makes for a less material, a lighter bridge.
It's an excellent example of that early construction. Now, that bridge stayed in operation well until the 1970s. At the time it was built, of course, automobiles were much smaller, narrower. The road deck, the portion of road that we actually travel on, was fairly narrow. It was just about 22 feet wide. So the bridge became obsolete.
And I think some of its importance within the state highway establishment is suggested by the fact that when the 101 was rebuilt in that area, they saved that bridge. They bypassed it and kept it in place as a monument to the work of the department.
By the time California's Highway Department finished the Arroyo Hondo Bridge in 1918, it had years of experience in building the Pacific Coast Highway. Those skills were about to be put to the ultimate test while building a road along the steepest coastline in the state, Big Sur. Some of the explosive powder used to blast the Pacific Coast Highway's path along Point Magoo was salvaged from hand grenades left over from World War I. The Pacific Coast Highway will return on Modern Marvels. Halfway between Los Angeles and San Francisco, the Pacific Coast Highway begins to hang right on the very edge of Central California's imposing coastal range. Building this section of road, highway crews were confronted with their biggest challenge. The dramatic cliffs and deep canyons around Big Sur are magnificent, but for engineers, they are a road-building nightmare.
Along this stretch of road, as you drive from San Simeon north, this is an emerging coastline. Geologically speaking, you're driving along a very young geologic environment, and the mountains are rising out of the sea. And if you drive along and you're thinking about that, you're sort of watching geology in action. The expression of that is landslides and rock falls. And thinking about that, it's a very interesting place to drive along and certainly unique around the world.
The new road was included in a 1919 California State Highway bond issue. Most of the surveying had to be done on horseback or on foot. In 1921, road work began at the Piedras Blancas Lighthouse, just above San Simeon, and headed north. By the fall of 1922, work had reached some of the most rugged and dangerous landscapes. Digging into the unstable slopes often triggered huge landslides.
There were times when steam shovels or caterpillars would be working that slides would occur that would engulf the machinery or equipment. I know there was one event that actually knocked a steam shovel about 500 feet down the cliff. The gentleman was able to ride that particular event out. He got out of the cab and walked away, and he went looking for employment in flatter land.
The slow and treacherous work was costing more than originally estimated and resulted in a 3-year halt in construction. Then in 1927, with a decision to use prison labor, work started up again. The inmates' backbreaking efforts were rewarded with reduced sentences and or pay of 35 cents a day. Skilled civilians handled the heavy equipment and the huge quantities of dynamite. 13 million cubic yards of earth were blown away to make an acceptable route for the road. The area between San Simeon and Monterey Bay is riddled with gorges and rivers. Engineers needed to design several bridges to traverse these. But that was just the beginning. The logistics of getting the materials on site, the unstable ground, and the unpredictable weather presented challenges to the builders, especially at an area known as Big Creek.
In 1937, there was a large storm here on the coast. You can see how windy it is today. Well, this is minor compared to what happened in 1937. They had 70 mile an hour winds that actually blew down the wooden falsework that was built to construct the bridge.
After the falsework was rebuilt and construction completed, the Big Creek Bridge was 597 feet long and comprised of two main arch spans of 177 and a half feet long and two tied half arches of 81 feet. But perhaps the bridge's real genius is in the two 34 and a half foot long swing spans that rest but are not attached to the abutments on either side of the canyon.
At both ends of the bridge, you'll see these half arches, which are cantilevered off of the towers. This enables the deck to float free of the abutments. The surrounding hillsides were deemed to be so unstable that it was necessary to not tie the road deck or the bridge deck into the abutments, allowing the bridge to float free, so that if there was landslide or movement at either end of the bridge would not be disturbed or torn away by that landslide.
Toward the northern end of this section of highway stands one of the most aesthetically spectacular and photographed spans in the world, the Bixby Bridge.
Bixby Bridge is known around the world for its beautiful design. It's an interesting bridge because, of course, it's on a curve. And initially, when they were looking at how to cross that enormous canyon, they looked at a variety of options. One would have been a tunnel through the mountain and a smaller bridge farther up the canyon. But they picked that location simply because it is spectacular.
The 150-foot high towers were built first, followed by the abutments and the approach slabs to the towers. Then the falsework was erected and the arches were cast. the Bixby's designers decided that an arch design would complement the contours of the canyon, and that concrete would more pleasingly blend with the scenery. From a practical standpoint, concrete was also less expensive and more resistant to the coastal conditions than steel. At 320 feet, the central concrete arch span was the longest in California. But the Bixby Bridge was designed with such precision that even though its long and slender arch might seem delicate, the way it distributes the load of its own weight and that of the traffic traveling across it gives it great strength.
The vertical load path of the bridge will go from the T-beam deck into each of the columns, and then from the columns into the arch. The arch will then take that load and distribute it to the two towers on either side of the bridge. That's the beauty of an arch. You can actually have supports for the structure that are located high up off the creek in case of a tsunami event or some kind of wave action that forces water to cause erosion of the structure.
The Bixby Bridge was completed in 1932 at a cost of just over $200,000. This beautiful blending of technology and nature helped the San Simeon to Carmel portion of Route 1 to be proclaimed California's first scenic highway. It's a distinction that must sound deceptively serene to those that toil to keep this very problematic road open.
This section of road along here, along Big Sur, has been mapped with over 1,000 landslides of various ages and in various stages of instability. So our road crosses all of these slides, or goes underneath many of them, or rides above many of these slides.
The crumbling cliffs have blocked the road several times over the years, but earlier solutions, such as cutting back the slopes or building massive retaining walls, have now become unacceptable in a place famous for its natural beauty. Recently, the California Department of Transportation began testing less intrusive, flexible wire mesh netting developed in Europe.
We put the netting up, we rolled rocks into it to see how much energy the nets could absorb. For example, if we rolled down a 2,000-pound rock, 1 ton, traveling at 40 or 50 miles an hour, these barriers were protecting it without any damage to the barrier, hitting the net with 70, 80, 90 foot-tons of impact energy. That kind of energy, if it hit a car, would push the car off the cliff.
The netting has been installed in various places along the highway and has also been used to neutralize an entire cliff called rain rocks for doing just that onto the highway below.
And the way the contractors did it, they came in, put anchors along the brow, and then with helicopters, flew in the nets and laid them on the slope. And then people would rappel down and fasten things up so that it knitted all together, if you will.
Covering the cliff with this netting has helped keep this world-famous stretch of highway open and safe for all those who come to enjoy its scenic wonders. But just up the road, even this breakthrough technology isn't enough to tame a disaster-prone spot called the Devil's Slide. In the year 2000, a seismic retrofit was completed on the Bixby Bridge to make it more earthquake safe. The retrofit's cost of $5.2 million was 26 times greater than the bridge's original construction cost in 1932. Pacific Coast Highway will return on Modern Marvels. After the wild ride through the twists and turns along Central California's coastal mountain range, Route 1 circumvents the tranquil beauty of Monterey Bay. But it's only a brief respite before the road is again wedged precariously between the sea and unstable mountains. Just south of the outskirts of San Francisco is one of the most troublesome spots along the entire Pacific Coast Highway system. It is aptly named the Devil's Slide. Before there was a road, the ill-fated Ocean Shore Railroad traversed it.
They started in 1905, and of course then in April of 1906, the great earthquake threw a wrench into that plan, and it actually did pitch some of the rails off the mountain and into the ocean. They began to rebuild shortly thereafter, but the very loose and deteriorated nature of the rock in that area It's constantly sliding and shifting.
Several landslides later, the Devil's Slide drove the railroad into bankruptcy. In 1914, a local road replaced the rails, and in 1933, the State Highway Department took over the road and made it part of the coast route. Landslides have damaged the road many times, and highway crews keep patching it back together. They've tried adding complex drainage systems and netting, but now it's clear that the only real lasting solution would be to reroute the highway inland and avoid the Devil's Slide altogether.
In a way, just as Devil's Slide represents one of the great failures of the Coast Highway, not far north of there is certainly one of the great achievements and one of the most spectacular spots on the road to this day, where the 1 and the 101 meet just at the north end of San Francisco and go across the Golden Gate Bridge, one of the most recognizable landmarks anywhere.
The Golden Gate Bridge was constructed between January 1933 and November of 1936. It was a monumental undertaking that cost $33 million and the lives of 11 workers. At a total length of 8,981 feet, it is one of the longest single-span bridges ever built. It's a suspension bridge in design, which means that the central span is held in position by the vertical cables that are attached to the two main cables slung high across the bridge. They transmit the weight of the deck and the live load to the towers and anchorages at both ends of the bridge. The designers of the Golden Gate Bridge managed to infuse the structure with such a sense of elegance that it almost masks how massive it really is. The two 756-foot-high towers were the tallest in the world when constructed. The diameters of the main cables are just over 3 feet. The weight of all the cables and their accessories is in excess of 24,000 tons.
In the Golden Gate Bridge, it was clear the builders knew they were doing something special. You look at the thing today, and unlike the gray or silver, you know, blending colors of virtually any other bridge you can think of, the Golden Gate is this bright red-orange. It stands out. It calls attention to itself. It says, hey, I'm here. We did this.
On the grade at the northern end of the Golden Gate Bridge is the Waldo Tunnel. The original one-bore tunnel was completed in 1937. By the 1950s, the increase in traffic made it necessary to widen the highway. But to widen the tunnel would have required the closure of this vital artery into San Francisco. The solution was to drill a second bore through the mountain to accommodate the two new lanes of highway. Not too far beyond the Waldo Tunnel, the coast route heads back to the shoreline and reverts to a two-lane, very windy road. Northern California's constantly shifting ground results in bulges and sags in the roadway, and is the reason why asphalt, instead of concrete, is the most practical road surface under these conditions.
Asphalt's used on a lot of roadways, and one of the main reasons it works in California, and particularly on Highway 1, is the fact that it's flexible. The road base itself is flexible, and then the asphalt on top is also flexible in that when the land underneath moves, which it does a lot out here, and particularly on the coast, the road moves with it. And also repairs are very easy if you have to go out and make one, whereas with concrete, once it breaks, it's very difficult to go in and repair it. It does not flex in the same way that asphalt does.
About 200 miles north of San Francisco, Highway 1 cuts inland for the last time, and Highway 101 becomes the coast route from here on. The decision was made that it would be just too hard, too expensive, and would serve too few travelers to warrant continuing Route 1 all the way up Northern California's mountainous coast. Road builders carved the path of the 101 through majestic redwood groves found along the banks of the Eel River. But keeping the road off the coast didn't mean it was safe from disaster. In 1964, tropical rains and a quickly melting snowpack turned the Eel River into a roaring torrent.
They called it the Killer Eel in 64. There was just logs and houses and debris coming down the river, and that lodged in some of the bridges, in the piers, and in the truss work of the bridges, and that's why some of the bridges failed.
Over 150 miles of this section of the highway were flooded, leaving damaged road and debris that would take months to clean up. Plans had already been in the works to widen the road in this area. But instead of using the old route right along the river, engineers rebuilt the road above the high water mark of the 1964 flood. Now travelers were assured a safer passage up to Oregon, where the dramatic coastline and wetter environment confronted road and bridge builders with a new set of challenges. A 1995 landslide closed the coast highway at the Devil's Slide for 5 months. It cost nearly $1.5 million to reopen the road. The Pacific Coast Highway will return on Modern Marvels. When the US 101 crosses the border from California into Oregon, it becomes what is now referred to as the Pacific Coast Scenic Byway. The nearly 400-mile route along Oregon's sometimes jagged and often rain-soaked shore began with just 2 miles of pavement in 1914 and took over 18 years to complete. A major bridge building program was also funded. Many of the most dramatic and artful spans were designed by Oregon's master bridge builder, a man named Condi B. McCullough.
C.B. McCullough came to Oregon in 1916 as a professor at what is today Oregon State University in Corvallis. As luck would have it, Oregon needed to build highways and, as part of that, bridges right after World War I. And McCullough became the state bridge engineer in 1919.
McCullough believed that bridges could be built both economically and aesthetically. 14 of the bridges along the Coast Highway are his designs. They range from small and practical to impressive structures of steel and concrete that leap for thousands of feet across Oregon's bays.
He really had a blank canvas here in Oregon for bridges, and he was able to tap all of his talents in creating a wonderful collection for the state of Oregon.
The Rogue River Bridge, built in 1931, is made up of 7 230-foot arch spans and 18 concrete approach spans. Its total length is nearly 1,900 feet. McCullough made it the first structure in the United States to use an innovative pre-compression technique developed by French engineer Eugène Freycinet that compensates for natural settling that occurs in arch bridges.
Normally, when an arch bridge is constructed, it's like that. And when you take the false work underneath it, it tends to just lower itself a little bit. On this bridge, McCullough designed the pieces in two separate parts, used 6 100-ton hydraulic jacks to jack it apart, put a closure pour in there so that the bridge was preloaded, and then he removed the false work. So as a result, here we are nearly 80 years later, and the bridge is just nice and level.
The Freycinet method also enabled McCullough to use less steel and concrete, which allowed him to incorporate thinner ribs that add to the aesthetic appeal of the bridge. Further up the coast, work began on the Coos Bay Bridge in 1934. At 5,305 feet, it's the longest and most expensive of the McCullough-designed bridges. He chose a steel cantilever truss because the volume of shipping made a drawbridge impractical. The cantilever truss enabled McCullough to build a high and wide shipping channel. It consists of anchor arms, spanning from the abutments to the main piers, cantilever arms that form part of the main span, and a suspended span, which is hung from the ends of the two cantilever arms to bridge the gap between them. Each of the anchor arms balances the weight of the corresponding cantilever arm. The two main towers that support the truss rise 280 feet above the water.
The flanking spans of it are very large concrete arch structures. They are decorated in McCullough style Art Deco, but you don't really appreciate Gothic arches in a structure until you drive onto the bridge and you go through the truss, because the cross members form Gothic arches in themselves, and you have the feeling that you're driving through a cathedral.
At Cape Creek, McCullough paid his respects to the ancient bridge builders of Europe with a Roman aqueduct-inspired design.
Well, here again, McCullough is finding the best bridge for the location. He has sandy soil foundations there that cannot really handle the heavy load of a bridge at particular locations. His goal here is to disperse the bridge's load. So how do you do that? You put it on many, many feet or many legs. And he achieved that through his use of a double-deck viaduct. And then he threw his little arch over Cape Creek.
In the city of Newport stands the 3,223-foot-long Yaquina Bay Bridge. Built in 1936, McCullough avoided building one bridge on a gigantic scale by designing what is, in essence, a series of small, sturdy bridges that are linked together across the bay.
It's a wonderful structure with a series of reinforced concrete deck arches, a 600-foot steel through arch, another steel deck arch, and a few more reinforced concrete deck arches.
This bridge has very spectacular detailing on it once again. Very, very much of McCullough's work picks up on artistic values of Europe and applied current technology, cutting-edge technology of that time.
By the time Oregon completed its coastal highway bridges in 1936, Washington had finished its portion of the 101 as well. But for another 29 years, there remained a 4-mile-wide gap in the road between Oregon and Washington, the mouth of the Columbia River. As traffic increased from the 1930s through the 1950s, the number of ferries used to get vehicles across the Columbia rose from 1 to 4.
And the 4 ferries was about all the docks could handle. In the summertime, they ran just as fast as they could back and forth from early in the morning till 10 o'clock at night, but the traffic was just more than they could handle.
In 1962, construction of a bridge finally began. Critics who fought funding the project had called it a bridge to nowhere, a name that didn't sit well with the people of Washington. The need for a tall and wide main shipping channel made a steel truss the most practical choice, just as it had been at Coos Bay. Here again, the weight of the long central suspension span in the middle of the bridge is counterbalanced by the flanking spans on the other sides of the main piers.
The main shipping span is 1,232 feet, and it's 200 feet above the water, which was high enough that would have allowed the largest naval vessel to have passed under the structure at high tide.
After passing through the steel truss on the Oregon side of the bridge, the next 10,000 feet of roadway runs at just 25 feet above sea level. Then it climbs again to 49 feet of clearance for the northern shipping channel. Pre-stressed concrete beam spans set on sturdy concrete piers were made part of the design. They ensured that the bridge would be able to withstand not only 150-mile-an-hour winds from Pacific storms, but also the floodwaters of the Columbia River. When completed, the Astoria Bridge's 4.1-mile span connecting Astoria, Oregon to Megler, Washington made it the longest bridge on the Pacific Coast Highway. Those who had dismissed it as the bridge to nowhere were quickly proven wrong. Within 5 months of its August 1966 opening, close to 250,000 vehicles had crossed the bridge. An uninterrupted drive along all of America's West Coast was finally complete. But the work was far from over. The dramatic and varied topography along the route of the Pacific Coast Highway that makes the road so special is also the very reason why it is one of the most difficult and expensive roads in the world to maintain. When the last of McCullough's Bay Bridges was completed in 1936, tourism on Oregon's Coast Highway jumped 72% the following year. The Pacific Coast Highway will return on Modern Marvels. The Pacific Coast Highway is a road of endless maintenance challenges, where it's sandwiched between the mountains and the sea in California. There's a never-ending battle with the natural forces of erosion. During the dry summer and early fall months, highway crews can often be found using earth-moving equipment to haul away debris and loose rock as a preventative measure. But when the winter storms return, it's one emergency after another.
California has been referred to as kind of a theme park of disasters for this country. And Pacific Coast Highway is the roller coaster.
When storms hit Southern California, floodwaters often rush out of the canyons and up and over portions of the road.
In 1938, at Santa Monica Canyon, there was a major flood that came down, and Pacific Coast Highway was this 300-foot-long waterfall going into the ocean. But also, after it's rained, and this is sort of the joke that nature plays on us, we're all starting to dry out, and about a month to 2 months later is when all the landslides happen.
Landslides can occur when the winter rains oversaturate the permeable cliffs, adding weight and lessening the cohesion of the soil. In 1958, one of the biggest occurred and became known as the Killer Slide. On the morning of March 27th, a sudden collapse left a 25-foot pile of earth on PCH.
The work to reopen the road took days. They brought in a huge amount of equipment, and it near the end of the construction, where they thought they had the road completely cut and was ready to go, they were making a determination as to whether the road should be reopened when the bluff suddenly cut loose again.
This time, 600,000 tons of earth collapsed towards the crew below. The men on bulldozers amazingly managed to ride up onto the slide and survive, but their supervisor was on foot and wasn't able to outrun it. To avoid further catastrophes like the Killer Slide, many types of retaining walls have been erected over the years in attempts to hold back the earth in this area. But now at one site, there's an elaborately designed new structure that has pushed the science of retaining walls to another level.
Some of the major features of this wall, first off, are these horizontal drains here. These are slotted PVC pipes that go back about 250 feet into the slope, and they collect water along their length and bring it out to the front here where it drains away. As you can see, this one is working pretty well right now. Now, this is a tieback. This is drilled about 120 feet back into the hillside. It's an 8-inch diameter hole, and strands are inserted into that and grouted in place 120 feet back. And then on this side of the wall, they get tensioned, kind of like post-tension bridge, where we have a big jack we put on this side, and we pull all those strands to a specified force and then lock it off with this big nut.
Each tieback is designed to withstand about 300 to 350,000 pounds of pressure. So as you can tell, we have a number of these tiebacks here, which should alleviate the pressure that the mountain is exerting on itself.
Aside from disaster repair and prevention, one of the biggest maintenance issues facing the entire highway and its bridges is simply age. A half a century after it was built, one of Condi B. McCullough's beloved Oregon bridges was deemed beyond repair.
The old Elsie Bay Bridge, like many of the other bridges along the Oregon Coast Highway, are in a very severe climate. They're close to the ocean. This, in the end, caused the bridge to fail. And salt water got into the concrete, seeped into the concrete, attacked the reinforcing bar, and undermined the bridge.
In 1992, the magnificent multiple-arched Elsie Bay Bridge was blown up. The new Elsie Bay Bridge, with its bold Y-shaped piers, is modern bridge building at its best. But out of deference to McCullough's historic design, it also features an impressive steel arch. Another of McCullough's beloved bridges, the Rogue River Bridge, was also showing its age. But now it's being given a new lease on life thanks to an innovative preservation method called cathodic protection. This scientific breakthrough uses an electric current to drive the negative ions that cause corrosion to an applied zinc coating instead of the steel rebar embedded in the concrete. But first, the aging bridge must be thoroughly checked for any damaged concrete or exposed rebar.
When the rebar corrodes, it actually expands. It can get up to 7 times its original diameter, and that causes the concrete to spall. So it's the rebar corrosion that causes most of the failure in the bridges. We have 3 preliminary surveys. 2 of them are to locate metal and then rebar that's within a 1/2 inch of the surface, because it will short out the zinc coating that we're putting on and bring it in contact with the rebar. And then we do a DLAM survey, which is where a guy goes over the surface and taps on every square inch with a hammer. And listens, and a hollow sound means the concrete is bad, and we remove it and replace it. And a ringing sound means the concrete is good.
Once any faulty concrete and rebar have been repaired or replaced, workers wearing special suits to protect their lungs from harmful overspray and their eyes from the blinding light apply the zinc coating.
The zinc comes in a wire form on spools, and we feed it through a zinc machine, which actually brings the zinc up to the melting point, and we spray molten zinc onto the surface and build up a 15 to 17 mil coating. The idea is we apply a uniform zinc coating over the entire surface of the bridge, and then we make some electrical connections between that coating and the rebar, and apply a low voltage current to it once the project's completed.
The zinc coating sacrifices itself and will protect the bridge an estimated 15 to 20 years. Then successive coatings can be applied to extend the life of the bridge well into the future. Along with their efforts in bridge preservation, a recently built structure at Brush Creek has put the Oregon Department of Transportation at the forefront of new bridge engineering as well.
We did 2 innovative things on this to help expand the life of the bridge radically. So we went to microsilica concrete, which is a very dense, low permeability concrete. That means that salt water takes forever to go through it. The other thing that we did was we used stainless steel reinforcing in the deck and the crossbeams.
These innovations have made the Brush Creek Bridge the first bridge designed to survive at least 120 years in the punishing coastal environment. After almost 100 years of floods, landslides, earthquakes, and the relentlessly pounding surf, the Pacific Coast Highway tenaciously clings to America's west coast. With the recent technological breakthroughs and the continuing vigilance and hard work by the state highway departments of California, Oregon, and Washington, motorists can still experience an unparalleled journey through natural beauty along a great human achievement.
Metal and then rebar that's within a 1/2 inch of the surface, because it will short out the zinc coating that we're putting on and bring it in contact with the rebar. And then we do a DLAM survey, which is where a guy goes over the surface and taps on every square inch with a hammer and listens, and a hollow sound means the concrete is bad, and we remove it and replace it, and a ringing sound means the concrete is good.
Once any faulty concrete and rebar have been repaired or replaced, workers wearing special suits to protect their lungs from harmful overspray and their eyes from the blinding light apply the zinc coating.
The zinc comes in a wire form on spools, and we feed it through a zinc machine, which actually brings the zinc up to the melting point, and we spray molten zinc onto the surface and build up a 15 to 17 mil coating. The idea is we apply a uniform zinc coating over the entire surface of the bridge, and then we make some electrical connections between that coating and the rebar, and apply a low voltage current to it once the project's completed.
The zinc coating sacrifices itself and will protect the bridge an estimated 15 to 20 years. Then successive coatings can be applied to extend the life of the bridge well into the future. Along with their efforts in bridge preservation, a recently built structure at Brush Creek has put the Oregon Department of Transportation at the forefront of new bridge engineering as well.
We did two innovative things on this to help expand the life of the bridge radically. So we went to microsilica concrete, which is a very dense, low permeability concrete. That means that salt water takes forever to go through it. The other thing that we did was we used stainless steel reinforcing in the deck and the crossbeam.
These innovations have made the Brush Creek Bridge the first bridge designed to survive at least 120 years in the punishing coastal environment. After almost 100 years of floods, landslides, earthquakes, and the relentlessly pounding surf, the Pacific Coast Highway tenaciously clings to America's West Coast. With the recent technological breakthroughs and the continuing vigilance and hard work by the state highway departments of California, Oregon, and Washington, motorists can still experience an unparalleled journey through natural beauty along a great human achievement.